Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Participatory Medicine Learning Exchange. I'm Sarah Krug, the Acting Executive Director of the Society for Participatory Medicine. I'm also the CEO of Cancer 101 and founder of the Health Collaboratory. Today, we will be talking about translating the patient's story into action, which is a topic I've spent my entire career advocating for, and it's an honor to partner with an esteemed panel of patients to showcase the power of patient stories and how to use these stories to implement change in healthcare. And I will introduce our panelists shortly. So although medical data, research, terminology, and ultimately the language of medicine are crucial building blocks within the foundation of healthcare, they can at times obscure the personal stories of those affected by healthcare's challenges and healthcare's triumphs, and what it actually feels like to live with a disease through the lens of those affected. The patient's story gives the language of medicine meaning. It fosters human connection and can be referred to as healthcare data with a soul. The magic of stories lies in the connections they foster and can help us learn and relate to one another. Stories can help us create new meaning around our personal journeys and promote healing, allowing us to reflect on our past, what we're currently going through, and what we hope for tomorrow. Stories can break down feelings of isolation and help us find support. They can inspire us and motivate us to push the limits and change the status quo so that perhaps what happened to me and my family doesn't happen to yours. And that's easier said than done. I first told my caregiver's story a couple years ago despite working with and advocating for patients my entire career. Losing my parents as a result of medical errors is what fueled my passion to make a difference and reshape healthcare. But for many years, I just wasn't ready to share my story. Now, learning how to tell our stories is just one side of the equation, but learning how to listen to those stories and ensure those voices are reflected in the design and development of healthcare, that's equally as important. These stories can shed light on real-world needs, issues, values, concerns, challenges, and they have the power to turn misfortune into change. So before we begin, I'd like to discuss the history behind the learning exchange. So participatory medicine is a movement in which network patients shift from being mere passengers to responsible drivers of their health, and in which providers encourage and value them as full partners. SPM's mission, it's to catalyze collaborative partnerships across the continuum of care to optimize health and healthcare. The Society's foundation is based upon four pillars, which include community building, advocacy and policy, research and education, which ironically spell care. Now, I encourage you all to take a look at our website to learn more. The Learning Exchange was created to help you showcase your work. Understanding the work we're conducting in our individual silos can help us learn from one another, allow us to build upon ideas, forge collaborations, provide a forum for feedback and suggestions, and hopefully avoid duplication of efforts. The Learning Exchange allows us to also capture how we're collectively moving the participatory medicine needle, whether it's through our day-to-day personal experiences with healthcare or our work in this area. Many thanks to our sponsors, Accenture and Vocera. Vocera, who's also graciously hosting our technicals through WebEx, offers the leading platform for clinical communication, and their mission is to simplify and improve the lives of healthcare professionals and patients while enabling hospitals to enhance quality of care and operational efficiency. Accenture is a Fortune Global 500 company that provides strategy, technology, and operation services in over 120 countries. I'd also like to thank John Novak at Inspire, who was instrumental in bringing together our panel of patients today. And now, the moment we've all been waiting for, I'd like to introduce our power panel of speakers and give you an overview of the next hour. We'll hear from four advocates affected by various conditions who will share their personal stories, but also provide us with a roadmap on how to turn our collective stories into action. We'll start out with a patient perspective from Julie Flaguer, an advocate and CEO of Project Sleep, who will reflect on her experiences with narcolepsy to provide us with tips on how to communicate our stories. Howard Chang, the social ambassador at the National Psoriasis Foundation, will then talk to us about how he's used his personal experiences with psoriasis to advocate for change. Chris Anselmo, the marketing intelligence manager at the Muscular Dystrophy Association, will then provide us with his personal rare disease perspective. And then we'll end with Dr. Annie Brewster, the founder of the Health Story Collaborative, who will talk to us about how storytelling can promote health based on her personal experience with multiple sclerosis. We'll then open it up to you, our audience, for questions, but feel free to ask questions throughout the presentation using the chat feature. Okay, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Julie Fliger, an advocate who lives with narcolepsy. Julie is the president and CEO of Project Sleep, a nonprofit to raise awareness about sleep health and sleep conditions. She's also the award-winning author of Wide Awake and Dreaming, a memoir of narcolepsy, and the creator of the Narcolepsy Not Alone campaign. Julie?
Thank you so much, Sarah. It's such an honor to be with this panel today, and thank you to John as well for inviting me. So I'm going to jump right in. My story really began in Boston. After I graduated from college, I moved into the Fenway District, just a few blocks from Fenway Park, which was pretty dreamy for me. And one of the first nights I lived in that apartment, I awoke to hear a burglar breaking in through the window in the living room. I was absolutely terrified, and I saw this man come at me with his arm stretched out towards my neck. But I couldn't respond. It was the weirdest thing. I wanted to kick him or run away, but I couldn't move. Next thing I looked up and he wasn't there. And it turns out he hadn't been there. A few weeks after that, my roommate and I were standing and we were joking in our living room. And as I laughed, my knees slightly buckled under me like someone had poked behind my knees. It was the strangest feeling. About a year after I moved to Boston, I started law school. And I was having a lot of trouble in law school getting through the dense readings and the classes, but I just thought maybe I wasn't meant for law school. It was just too tough for me or something. Turns out I finally found out that the burglar, the knee buckling laughter, and my trouble with law school, my sleepiness, were all symptoms of narcolepsy. And when I first saw that word narcolepsy, I thought, I couldn't have that. That's just a joke about someone falling asleep while they're standing. But turns out I was officially diagnosed with a real condition of narcolepsy at the beginning of my second year of law school. So I thought I would just go back to my life as planned. This is just gonna be a little road bump. I would start taking treatments and get better. As I'm sure many people on this call know, that's not always how it goes. Treatments were not a quick fix and they had a lot of side effects as well. At the same time, when I started telling people that I had narcolepsy, I was really startled by their responses. I mean, I had thought narcolepsy was a joke too, right? I'd seen Rat Race and Moulin Rouge. I had laughed at those characters. But now I didn't have the communication tools yet to explain that this wasn't a joke. So I pretty much stopped telling people. And when I graduated from law school in 2009, I'd kept my narcolepsy private for about 2 years at that point. But I realized we were kind of caught in this catch-22. We didn't like misperceptions of narcolepsy, so we stayed silent, perpetuating those misconceptions and our silence, and I thought someone has to break this cycle. So I decided to take on writing a memoir about my experience with narcolepsy, and I moved to Washington, D.C. at that time as well to start advocating on Capitol Hill. I did have a creative nonfiction background, so I'll say that wasn't completely out of the blue. But I wanted to just share this slide to show, you know, this progression that my journey as a storyteller was a gradual process. I didn't wake up the first day with a diagnosis and think, I'm going to write a book and found a nonprofit and train other people to start telling their story. It's been a really long, beautiful process of kind of continuing to increase my voice. And so I just wanted to go over a little bit about why share your story. When we were having the discussion before this webinar, I thought of a really important point that often I think we think of sharing statistics as raising awareness. And there's somewhat of a myth that if you share your story, it's because you like hearing yourself talk, that you just think that, you know, you want a fan club. People might think that you want attention or you have bad motives like financial or you want to be a celebrity or it's a popularity contest. But I know for me, I tell my story and share my photos not because I think I'm special, but because I think these are the tools I was given to paint my story of narcolepsy. And I guess it was intuitive to me that I believed people remembered stories and faces over facts and stats. So it has been really interesting to actually learn, though, that you don't have to just take my word for that. There's some really wonderful research. This is one of my favorite books, Made to Stick. If you haven't read that yet, go on Amazon and purchase it. And it has this wonderful example about a donation request letter from Save the Children. Researchers tested two versions of this donation request letter, one with stats and one with info about one young girl. And it turned out that the average donation for the, was almost double when they do the one for the one young girl. So then researchers thought, okay, well, maybe the sweet spot would be information from both letters, stats and information about the girl. And it showed that actually the donation for that letter was almost a dollar less than the one that just had information about the girl. So I can't recommend this book enough. It shows you how to weave in facts and stats to make them effective and how to make your story sticky. But I just thought this is a little theoretical, but it's one of the most wonderful things I've found to explain why we continue to perpetuate misconceptions that raising awareness is just sharing information through stats. This is information deficit model was coined in the 1980s to describe a widely held belief that much of the public's skepticism about science was rooted in lack of knowledge. If only the public knew more, they would be more likely to embrace scientific information. And a wealth of research has shown, that wealth of information doesn't change in people's views. I think healthcare, healthcare is still a little bit stuck in this model of thinking. If only we give people more fact sheets, more alarming stats, they will somehow care. I think the alternative to this is your story. And the reality is that research shows that storytelling is extremely important to, it's invaluable for public education, and audiences are much more likely to engage and retain information. So I've put a bunch of research here in case you're as dorky as me and like to read all the research. I won't go into it today, that could be a whole different presentation. In 2017, so 10 years after I was diagnosed, my nonprofit, Project Sleep, started the Rising Voices of Narcolepsy program. And here is one of our speakers and one of our writers. We train people on how to share their story through speaking and or writing. And I just wanted to point out that it not only leveraged my experience as a storyteller, but we also had a health communications expert, and we looked at 8 successful story sharing training programs. And I just wanted to highlight quickly that Health Story Collaborative was one of them, and how honored I am to be on this call with Annie, and can't wait to hear more about what she has to say, because we developed our program in part from hers. So I'm just gonna close with 2 tips. One is to use exact places and times in telling your story. I think when especially we are dealing with chronic conditions, there's this very natural inclination to go to generalities and to say something like, I experience sleepiness every single day. You know, I'm so tired every single day of high school, I couldn't keep my eyes open any day. That's logical, right? Because every day is much worse than one day. So if something affects you every day, like in mathematical terms, that should be more impactful. But I think how our brains actually work is that we need to build on those one-day experiences. So in our Rising Voices of Narcolepsy program, I'm really bringing our advocates, I'm challenging them to bring it down to one day. How did that affect you the first time you felt that sleepiness? And to use examples that say something like, one of the first times I felt sleepy, I didn't have anywhere to go. I was in school, and I ducked into the theater and sat in a theater chair curled up to hide and to take a nap. That brings the person into the place with you, and they can visualize it, and they can see from your perspective. I think this is probably another great point, could be its own, but include loved ones as much as possible in your example stories. Because it really also gets to the fact that you're more than just a patient. You're a person. You have so many different aspects to your life. And I know from one of the first presentations I gave, I read a passage from my book where the scene with my dad. And afterwards, this big burly man came up to me and said that, you know, he didn't know what it was like to have narcolepsy, but he knew what it was like to be a dad. And, you know, to think about protecting his daughter and his daughter being sick. So that's what got him to empathize. So loved ones are super powerful. Pets are powerful too, if you have any stories about involving pets. My last tip I just wanted to point out is to try to build balance and positive moments in your story. This doesn't mean that you have to have a happy ending. It doesn't mean that you have to found that, you know, your illness is a gift or any sort of cheesy thing like that. It's just really important to think about establishing trust and avoiding inducing anxiety or discomfort in your audience. And I truly believe that having highs in your story helps your audience empathize with your lows. It's kind of that, just creating that balance. And there's a lot of really sneaky, kind of cool ways you can do that. You know, for our Rising Voices advocates, I explained that narcolepsy can be the bad guy, but you're the hero tackling that. So positivity can be brought into your however you're telling anyone by saying, but you know what, I'm really proud to be here today and to be telling my story, or I'm going to a conference that brings me together with other people. One of our advocates had a great example too, where she said she was going through many, many misdiagnoses, doctor to doctor to doctor. And in that example, she said, my mom was so great, helping me with all the appointments. Now, that had nothing to do with narcolepsy, but it was wonderful because she showed positivity in saying that her mom was great. So that's what I prepared today. I could talk forever. I'm trying not to. I just wanted to leave you with one of the most influential quotes that got me going early on my journey. I could never figure out again who ever said it. I think it might have been an ad, maybe for even the ACLU or something like that. But it said, if you don't like what someone else says, find your own platform and speak louder. So thank you again for having me, and that's all I had prepared.
Thank you so much, Julie, for sharing your story and the tips you've provided. So I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Howard Chang. And again, just to remind the audience, if you do have questions, feel free to write them into the chat function, and we will save them until the end. So our next speaker is Howard Chang, who has lived with severe psoriasis and eczema for close to 40 years. He's a National Psoriasis Foundation Social Ambassador and Advocacy Action Network volunteer. Howard recently celebrated a decade of writing his psoriasis column, The Itch to Beat Psoriasis, on Everyday Health, and also has various blogs where he actively shares his message. Howard is also an ordained minister who has worked in churches for close to two decades. Howard?
Thanks, Sarah. Thanks. Hi, everyone. It's so great to be on this great panel and talking about something that is something I'm so passionate about. As Sarah said, I'm a minister, so you can see my pictures here. And I was able to accomplish an advanced degree in seminary a couple of years ago, which I think was really a triumph for me given all the health issues I had over the years. And there I'm doing a wedding there. So I'm a full-time pastor. I don't do advocacy full-time, but I enjoy doing it, and it's a passion of mine. That's why I wanted to show these pictures. So my story really starts about when I was 8 or 9, and I did this panel for teens at the National Psoriasis Foundation, the volunteer conference, and so my daughter drew this cartoon for me, and it shows that when I'm about 9 or 10, when I'm getting diagnosed, and it was just a really scary time for me, and you can see in the bottom left of the cartoon that I'm coming out of a light box phototherapy unit, and just really scary. So that was, I think, when you're a kid getting diagnosed with something, a chronic condition, it's pretty, to me, pretty scary situation. So this is about as bad as it gets for me. I was about 95% covered. And you can see that picture on the right. And that was, I think, about 10, 12 years ago. And during this time, I was in a very dark place. I was depressed. I probably was a bit suicidal, too. I was, and wanted to quit my job. So it was a pretty devastating time for me. And out of this time, I was able to find a medication that was really very toxic, but I needed to try it, and it helped start to clear me. And as I started to clear, I wanted to do something with this experience I had. And so I started writing, And I've been blogging since 2007. And my blog, The Should Be Psoriasis, started as a smaller blog with health talk. And over the years, it was bought out. And now it's on Everyday Health. I have hundreds of articles on there and just trying to tell the story in so many different angles and ways and to continue the story. This blog has been really helpful in doing that. And I also write for some other sites, and you can see those up there. So Howard is my personal website. So just lots of experience telling my story and kind of sharing what it's like to live with psoriasis, especially the emotional, spiritual, and psychological aspects of it, and also deal with some other aspects such as treatments and so forth. The community, I think, is really still struggling with trying to find good treatments. There's more and more now, but there's a lot of fear with some of the new treatments as well. So just continuing to tell a story to empower and inspire patients to continue to pursue health and wholeness. And then so I started telling about other stories, and here's a couple examples. So the one on the right, I was able to interview Cindy Lauper, and that's I think it was last year when she was doing a campaign with one of the pharmaceutical companies. And just this last couple months, I interviewed three fellow advocates and shared their story about psoriatic arthritis. So my story became telling other people's story, and I think that was a significant step forward for me. And the thing that I have in terms of how I extended my story into action is taking the next step. And I thought of all these different elements that were part of my taking the next step in advocacy. And the example for me that where all of these elements came into play was when I started advocating from local offices to legislators to Sacramento. I live in California. I live near Sacramento Capitol, but no excuse. And then to Capitol Hill last couple years. And during this time, it was a new opportunity for me, but I was scared. It was not an easy thing for me to do. I think the first time I was in an office at the assembly house in Sacramento, I was so afraid. I could barely talk. And so it was a new opportunity for me. It was something that I needed to stretch myself. And there was this element of greater intentionality as well, where I became more purposeful in being and deliberate in the way that I did advocacy, and I did more research, and I started to refine my story to tell the legislatures and to be able to share that story in a way that would impact healthcare from a broader scale. And fresh angle, it was something different about my story. It wasn't just telling what happened to me, but how it impacts other people and how I could extend my experiences and help others. Increased involvement, so I started getting more involved in advocacy, and that's how I got to Capitol Hill, I think. Personal growth, just a lot of courage taking these steps. They said I experienced a lot of anxiety and fear in doing this kind of advocacy. I enjoyed being behind a computer screen, being able to tell my story in my way, in my time, but to do that in real time was a big stretch for me. And so there was a lot of personal growth involved. And then strengthening connections, just being able to work with others, so to get more involved in the broader psoriasis community and also in the advocacy committee community. So I think this was a great example for me of how I extended my story and took it to the next step. And there's another arc that I wanted to share in terms of taking the next step, and that is just through the relationships that I built. And I shared that, I enjoyed writing for many years, but I did that in isolation. And coming out and starting to meet others who were blogging, who were advocating in the psoriasis community was a first step for me. And these were vital connections that I was making. People that maybe I had heard of but I had never met, or maybe I didn't even know that I needed to know them in terms of thought I was by myself and isolation, that I was fine. But getting out into the community through the National Psoriasis Foundation, local events and some national events really helped me see that there was this bigger world out there in community that I was sharing not just my own story, but I was sharing a collective story with others who were going through similar experiences that I was with psoriasis. And then a big breakthrough for me was the Healthy Voices conference for online patient advocates. And I went to the first one about 4 years ago, and I've gone to all four. I think I was one of 12 or 15 that went to all four. And here there were about, last time there were 120 attendees from 40 different disease states. And it was just it's so impactful for me to talk about my story and to share with other people's stories in terms of what they had gone through with, let's say, diabetes or rheumatoid arthritis or HIV, mental illness. And to see that our stories are actually a lot more similar than I probably would have thought before meeting these other advocates. And just being a part of that community, I think, was huge for me, just to see that there was something broader than just psoriasis. And from community, I started to build collaboration. So I have a picture of my doctor. She's not my doctor anymore, because I had some issue with insurance changing over. Dr. Mavrakis and I started to do some local National Psoriasis Foundation events. I was able to interview him some of his research. He's a cellular immunologist at UC Davis, and he was able to use some of my work in one of his grant proposals. So that was a really important collaboration for me in working with my doctor and seeing my doctor not as just someone prescribing medications, but as someone that I could, you know, really do something with and in terms of advocacy. And the middle picture is Matt Eisman. I did this event for Janssen with a couple other advocates for research immunology researchers at Janssen, and another psoriasis national awareness for psoriasis event at another company. And a big collaboration for me is Chronic Parents, that came out of the Healthy Voices conference. And it's a Facebook group, and we do Twitter chats for parents with a chronic illness. And we're mostly targeting parents who have older kids, but we have all kinds of parents. And that's been an exciting collaboration with another diabetes and RA advocate. So just quickly, my motivation, and you know, I had all these kind of motivations, help one person. It was a redeeming experience for me, and so Healthline said this, quoted me on this slide, this tweet, "Life's about giving back and helping others, so going into advocacy was natural for me." And just a reminder for me that all this, all the action that I do and all that I do for advocacy, that to me, it all started with helping one person, and so I want to just end with that. I think I'll skip over my last slide here because I'm running out of time, but this is just about self-care and something that I'm learning more about myself, and just that as we advocate and as we tell our stories, to make sure that we take care of ourselves as well. Thanks for allowing me to join this panel and for allowing me to share my story.
Thank you, Howard, for sharing your journey and how you've been able to help others through your work and, you know, really turn your story into our stories. So our next speaker is Chris Anselmo. Chris is a Connecticut resident living with an adult onset muscle disease called limb-girdle muscular dystrophy type 2B. Chris is a market intelligence manager at the Muscular Dystrophy Association. Chris?
Thanks, Sarah. Hi, everyone. My name is Chris Anselmo, and as Sarah said, I'm a market intelligence manager at the Muscular Dystrophy Association. And today I'm going to share with you my patient story and kind of from the angle of a rare disease patient. So my particular condition is extremely rare, less than 10 per million. So I have a very unique kind of perspective on that. And then I'll provide some advice on just kind of what I've learned through my patient story on how to become an advocate and just some kind of tips and learnings that I've accumulated over the years. So just a little bit about me, 31 years old. I'm a Connecticut native. Living in Connecticut now, but I'd been living in Boston for about 12 years, from 2004 to 2016. My form of muscular dystrophy, it goes by many names. It's most commonly known as limb-girdle muscular dystrophy type 2B. It's also known as Meoshi myopathy distal muscular dystrophy. There's a whole host of names that it could be called. So I have a marketing degree from Northeastern University, an MBA from Boston College, and I'm currently working at the Muscular Dystrophy Association. Now, what's kind of unique about my story and was hard at first to relate to others about, because this doesn't happen to a lot of people, is that for the first 21 years of my life, I had no symptoms whatsoever. I, you know, played basketball in high school. I ran track. I did all sorts of active things. And it was only because of a freak accident, a car accident in high school, that I even knew I had an underlying condition, sort of like a ticking time bomb, if you will. A blood test had determined that I had a very high abnormal level of a certain protein. And, you know, they thought that I had suffered an internal injury. And then after all sorts of different, seeing all sorts of different specialists, they determined that I had actually an underlying muscle disease, which I thought was really surprising given the fact that I had no symptoms. Again, I was active, I was healthy, and I felt perfectly fine. So I kind of had that in the back of my mind, but I never really took it seriously. One second, I have to cough. I apologize. I love to play basketball. Again, I loved sports. I would go to any sporting event I could while I was in college in Boston. I'd be at Fenway Park all the time. I'd be at Boston Garden all the time. And I just loved sports. I loved playing sports, watching sports, enjoying the city of Boston as much as I could. And then I graduated college from Northeastern in 2008 when literally like a few weeks afterwards, I was going for a run around a park nearby where I lived, and I just pulled up a lot more. Like, I just felt this burning sensation in my legs, so I just couldn't run another step. And I was looking at where I had run the last time and saw that, you know, there's hundreds of feet between where I stopped the previous time and where I stopped this time. And I knew that something was wrong. I kind of had a sense it could be related to my disease, but at the time, it didn't really register. And then, you know, it was just a very difficult time as I started to get weaker. So in the next few years, I, you know, just continued to get weaker. I was moving to an apartment, and then I had struggled to carry stuff up the stairs. My condition continued to progress. And then, you know, about 3 years into it, I fell for the first time. Like, I had just gotten so weak that I just couldn't I couldn't take another step, and then I just fell to the ground. It was a very scary feeling, not being able to support your own body weight. And that really threw me into a terrible depression. You know, I was comparing my life to those around me. I, you know, was seeing my friends, you know, get married, they were buying houses, they're progressing in their careers, and I was worried about whether or not if I took another step, if I was going to fall on my way home from work. And you know, my upper body continued to weaken. I started to struggle going up the stairs. It's just this relentless progression from 2008 when I first had symptoms on through 2012 when it just kept getting worse and worse and worse. And then around 2013, I kind of had my breaking point where I just couldn't take it anymore. And, you know, I fell one particular night while walking home from work and I couldn't get up under my own power. You know, had to use two parked cars to push myself off the ground with all the strength in my body to get into a standing position. And it was just a very traumatic moment for me. And, you know, it was extremely difficult to deal with. And I couldn't relate to anybody. I just, you know, kind of clammed up and just wouldn't, you know, open up to anybody about what was going on. And, you know, I came to realize that that was actually probably the worst thing that could have happened at that time. It was only through experience that I was able to figure that out. And then in 2013, I kind of had a paradigm shift, I like to call it. Unfortunately, in early 2013, I lost a cousin and I lost a very close friend to illness within a three-week span. And it really kind of forced me to think about how I was dealing with my own condition. You know, I saw them go through what they were going through and they were handling it with grace, they were handling it with a positive attitude, and here I was just angry and bitter and just not able to really relate to anybody and not really opening up to anybody. And I realized that that had to stop. So I started to be more proactive. I reached out to the Muscular Dystrophy Foundation, Muscular Dystrophy Association, and the Jane Foundation. I was trying to find a cure for my disease to kind of see how I would help. And one of the common things that they're saying is, you know, there aren't that many people that have your condition. And, you know, whatever you can do to raise awareness would be fantastic. So I kind of took that mantle. I always loved to write. So I began blogging. MDA had a website called Transitions. It no longer exists, but it's an opportunity for me to write about my life with my disease. I also started a blog called Sidewalks and Stairwells. I kind of wrote about my day-to-day life, not really sure who the audience would be or if anybody would be interested in reading it, but just kind of almost as a way, it was almost therapeutic in a way to kind of just, you know, unburden myself and let people know what was going on and kind of what I was dealing with both physically and emotionally. And that really opened a lot of doors. I, you know, got invited to go to a specific research conference where I got to meet other researchers that were working on my condition. I got to meet other patients. I got to connect with them. I got to learn, you know, what resources they used. It really became kind of a healing process for me. And in doing so, I met three researchers in the Boston area who each had family members living with muscular dystrophy and who had dedicated their careers to finding a cure for various forms of MD. And I helped them to co-organize a fundraiser called Strength, Science, and Stories of Inspiration, which we do every year to 2 years in Boston, which is raises money for muscular dystrophy research, raises awareness by sharing patient stories. And it's a really powerful and emotional night. And it's really been a great feeling to be able to interact with and meet different patients and researchers and members of the muscle disease community. And it's really kind of motivated me to become an advocate and to continue to raise awareness to find other patients that have my condition. And, you know, through all of this outreach, you know, it doesn't come naturally to me because I'm kind of an introvert. I'm not a naturally outgoing person. But in doing so, I've been able to connect with other patients who have I've been able to learn their story. I've been able to kind of connect them to the resources that have helped me. You know, I've even been able to help them emotionally, just kind of talk through kind of what they're going through. And it's been a very rewarding experience. And so what I wanted to conclude with my remaining time is just kind of share some advice, share some tips for what I've learned through the process, because I've made every mistake in the book. You know, I've clammed up and not shared what I was going through with anybody. I take that experience and I kind of I've learned from it, just kind of knowing what not to do. And the first thing is, if you're a rare disease patient, to know that you're really more valuable than you know on many levels. But first of all, there aren't that many of you if you have a rare disease, so it's really important that you're an active, engaged patient, whether you're participating in clinical studies or clinical trials or raising awareness. You know, just the cost of not doing that, of not being engaged and active, I mean, it hurts yourself, it hurts the rest of the community. It's just, it's really important that you're, you know, out there trying to be kind of an engaged patient and really be active, because that's the more patients you can find that have your condition, the better the chances that, you know, the drug industry will be interested in, you know, taking on your particular condition for research. And then kind of second to that is learn about your condition as much as you can. Many doctors are well-intentioned, but they may not be familiar with all the rare diseases in the world. So if you can kind of become sort of an expert on that yourself, you know, you can educate the doctor, and then if they see another patient that might have a similar symptoms, then they might be able to kind of direct them to the proper resources. And also you can kind of self-direct your own care. The more you know, the more knowledgeable you are, you know, you could reach out to the specialists that are experts in your condition, that sort of thing. Be prepared to wear many hats. So if you're going to have to be a writer, you might have to be a speaker, you might have to be a therapist to other patients, you might have to be kind of a salesman in a way, just kind of, you know, talking, if you're talking to a patient about, you know, the importance of becoming an engaged patient and, you know, registering with a certain foundation, they might not be comfortable with that off the bat. So you might have to kind of show them sort of the value proposition of why that's important. And also you become an ambassador. You know, if you're speaking or writing about your disease to a general audience, you're going to be the person that can kind of carry that mantle and be kind of a face for that disease. And, you know, and kind of along those lines, sharing your story by blog or social media or speaking or whatnot is really important because, you know, again, just raising awareness. And also, since there's so few of you, if you have a certain rare disease, you know, the more people that can do that, the better. You know, it may not be something that comes naturally. It didn't come naturally to me, for example, but it's just incredibly important. And you don't have to be like an expert writer or public speaker. you know, almost every patient story you hear is powerful in its own way. As long as you're authentic, as long as you are, you know, honest about what you're going through, you'll become more comfortable sharing it and you'll become a better storyteller. And then lastly, just embrace being a connector. If you reach out, you know, if you're blogging and somebody reaches out to you, you know, it may at first, you may not be totally comfortable with it, but, you know, over time you'll get more comfortable connecting with people, connecting them to resources, being sort of a support person for them, explaining what you went through to kind of help to guide them if they're on the early stages of their disease journey. And it'll become easier over time. And it's a very valuable and vital, thing to do. Again, you might not be totally comfortable with it, but there's just so many benefits to connecting with other people, because they can add them to your patient community, and then they can become connectors themselves. So thank you again. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them in the Q&A. Thanks.
Thank you, Chris, for sharing your rare disease perspective and your tips on becoming an advocate. So our last speaker is Dr. Annie Brewster, who is both a physician and a patient. She is assistant professor at Harvard Medical School and a practicing internist at Massachusetts General in Boston, where she works in urgent care and at the Benson Henry Institute for Mind-Body Medicine. She's also lived with multiple sclerosis since 2001. Motivated by her belief in the power of stories to improve health, Annie started recording patient narratives where she's seen firsthand how the process of storytelling itself is therapeutic, both for storytellers and the listeners. So she co-founded the Health Story Collaborative as a result of this work, and she'll talk to us about that today. Annie?
Thank you, Sarah. I'm really happy to be part of this webinar. And thank you, Julie, Howard, and Chris. It was really wonderful for me to hear your stories, and so much of what you said resonated. So we don't have a lot of time, but I just wanted to tell you a little bit about my story and how I have sort of worked to translate that into action in my work. So Sarah already said a lot of introduction here. So I'm a patient diagnosed in 2001, also a physician, and then I say my true passion is really this work that I do at Health Story Collaborative, and really we're dedicated to creating spaces and opportunities for patients and their loved ones to engage in the process of story sharing with the goals of healing, empowerment, and transformation. And so, and we base all of our programming on research that shows the health benefits of narrative. So how did I get here? I'll tell you a brief version of my story. It really comes out of my personal experience of both being a doctor and a patient, and really a strong desire to try and make healthcare better for both, because I really saw problems with both. So as a doctor, I started training in the late 90s. I always thought I would become sort of a family doctor, but I had a vision of probably what medicine was like 100 years ago, where I wanted to know my patients and the context of their lives and really feel connected to them. And I ended up in primary care and was really sort of heartbroken by the way the system is now. And I know that sounds dramatic, but it was really true. You know, I found myself in this system that clearly valued efficiency and the financial side of healthcare over human relationships. It really felt like more of a factory than really being able to care for people. And I was discouraged by that. And then also what I think made me the most sad was that what was supposed to be a therapeutic alliance, this relationship that I had with my patients, sometimes felt almost antagonistic because we had these competing demands on us, you know, doctors feeling rushed and patients really feeling like they want to be heard, and then nobody feeling satisfied. So the wheel started turning then of sort of how can I make this system better. And then at the same time, sort of on a parallel track, I had my illness story. In 2001, I was an intern training to the first year of residency there, which is busiest in my training to become a doctor, and I was diagnosed with MS. And for me, this was like a huge identity meltdown, sort of. Everything I sort of understood about myself crashed down. So I'd always been someone who could sort of persevere my way through anything, who could always find my way through any struggle, and then suddenly I had this disease for which there was no cure. And so I kind of had a little bit of an identity meltdown, though I wouldn't have necessarily named it that at the time, but I didn't really acknowledge and accept my disease for close to 5 years. So I really had a lot of shame about it, and I felt angry with myself and my body for letting me down, and I told hardly anyone except those closest to me. And I really started to realize over that time that healing for me was going to be impossible unless I could learn how to accept and integrate my diagnosis. So it was a long process, but over time I started to do that, and I started to understand that healing is not synonymous with curing. So even though there was no cure, I could find a way to heal myself. And I could, you know, go beyond fighting disease and really just enduring illness and actually maybe find a way to reframe it, see it differently, and to find strengths and new perspectives and actually see myself as stronger rather than weaker because of my illness. And so I really was yearning for that and for finding that healing. And what I was craving at that time was to hear stories from other people. I wanted to hear examples of other people that had been given a diagnosis like mine, but had found a way to move forward in a positive way, even if they were not cured or even sometimes if they were terminal. I think you can still heal even in that case. And so I wanted examples of that because I wasn't really ready to go to a support group, but I wanted to hear those narratives. And I couldn't really find them. So that's what led me to think, how can I help? How can I take action here? How can I create something that will help others? And so another thing that was really important for me to realize was that I had some power, that even though we can't always control what happens to us and we get a disease that we can't cure, we can choose our attitude. So I have this quote here by Viktor Frankl that's sort of the last of the human freedoms. But to me, that's the most important freedom, that we can choose our attitude and the way we're going to see it and how we're going to move forward in the face of a challenge. And storytelling really spoke to me. So I wanted to hear these narratives from others. I couldn't find them, so I decided to start collecting them, and that's what I did. And my vision at that point was to make an archive of stories for others so that they could access it when they were navigating a new diagnosis and find hope and find possibility in listening. Not necessarily of cure, but of moving forward in positive ways. And what I learned in doing that was that, yes, these stories were very valuable to the listeners, but that actually the process of story sharing itself was very therapeutic for those telling the stories. And so that led to Health Story Collaborative. And as I said, we base a lot of our work on research. And so I'm going to tell you a little bit about that research in the 4 minutes I have left. But we are lucky to have at Health Story Collaborative someone named Jonathan Adler, who's a psychologist. He's our chief academic officer. He's a professor at Olin College. But his field of study is on narrative psychology, which is focused specifically on something called narrative identity. And this really grounds out our work. And what it shows is that there is therapeutic value in telling your story and that not all stories are equal. How we tell those stories makes a difference in terms of our health. But before I tell you about his work, I'll just back up quickly to say there is a lot of research, which I don't have time to dig into, on the health benefits of listening to stories, so being on the receiving end. So we all know that social isolation is bad for us. Loneliness is toxic. It's been linked to cognitive and physical decline and increased mortality. We know that support groups are beneficial and that they can help people physically and emotionally. We know that intimacy keeps people alive longer. We know that networks help people just do better overall. There are also specific studies that show with particular diseases like high blood pressure and diabetes that hearing stories from other people who have your diagnoses can actually help you in terms of improved diet, improved exercise, communicating more with your doctors. And then really specifically, there's one study that shows your blood pressure values can even be better if you hear these stories, even with controls who are on all the same medication. So it's valuable. We also know that how your story is received and having it received by someone who's empathic makes a big difference and promotes health. So there are a ton of studies on this showing that if patients perceive of their healthcare provider as empathic, they do better across all sorts of diseases. So let me tell you a little bit about John Adler's research and the field of narrative psychology. So it's based on this thing called narrative identity, and that's really the belief that who we are, our identity, is shaped by the stories we tell. And so while we can what matters in our lives more than what happens to us and the facts of our lives is the meaning we make out of what happens to us reflected in the stories we tell. And so we have some control over that. Also, we know that how you tell your stories matters, okay? So they're not all going to be equal in terms of promoting health. So there are some narrative themes that have been studied that come through, and the more of certain themes in your story, the better your mental health is going to be. These themes are agency, sort of the feeling that you're in control, that you are not just being batted around by fate, that you are an active person in that story. That's very clearly associated with positive mental health. Communion, that's connection with others. The more we see themes of communion, the better the mental health. Redemption, so stories when something goes from bad to good, that's also linked to positive mental health. And then coherence, which is more about structure than content, but being able to weave all the stories of our lives into one coherent whole. So that's really fundamentally about integration. How do we integrate? So we have a lot of programming at Health Story Collaborative that really pulls for these themes and helps people to shift their stories by the questions we ask. Now, that doesn't mean you can't embrace what's negative in your story. In fact, you have to. So what we do know about well-being is that there are two ways to get there. There's this kind of hedonic processing, which is more about pain avoidance and pleasure seeking. And then there's this eudaimonic processing, which is about meaning making and deep processing. And that deep processing piece is critical to well-being. And that means facing what's hard and bringing it together. So that's very brief, and I'm happy to answer questions about it. There's tons out there. But I think the most important thing to remember from my point of view is that storytelling is a relational act, so we're all involved in it. It's the storyteller, it's the story listener, and it's the story itself, all involved in this intricate dance. And we all can shape each other. So when I tell my story to somebody, how they respond to my story is going to affect how I tell it next time, and it's going to shape my identity in some small way as a result. And that story is going to impact the listener and how they tell their own stories. And so it's never static. It's this continually evolving process. But in it, there's power because it shows us that we have some control even when we feel like all the control has been taken away from us when we get a terrible diagnosis, that we have a choice and we can actually help people to heal in how we listen and the questions we ask. And we can also, in our own stories, think about these themes, and I heard it in all of the stories that were shared today, the agency, the communion, the redemption, all of these things, and that's how we can move to a healing place. And that's all I'm going to say because that's all I have time for, but I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you, Annie. So thank you all for sharing your profound stories, your tips, and for all the advocacy work you do on behalf of patients and their families. We'll get started with questions from the audience. Again, if you have any questions, please type them in to the chat feature, and we'll try to get through as many as possible. Okay, so I'm going to start with a couple of general questions for all of our panelists today. First question, how might we encourage more patients' advocates to become human-centered storytellers instead of just focusing on the negative? Would any of you like to take that question on?
Chris, I see you just unmuted. Chris, I think, spoke to that beautifully, and so maybe he can answer it.
Sorry. Can you just repeat, the first part of that question?
So the question is, again, how can we encourage other patients, other advocates to become human-centered storytellers instead of them just focusing on the negative? So how can we bring out some of the positive and turn some of these advocates that are out there into human-centered storytellers?
Yeah, so I think if you think about kind of when people do focus on the negatives, and this is, again, just pulling off of my experience having done that for so many years, I think there's just that expectation that what you're going through is, like, you're the only person in the world that's having these things happen. Once you kind of have that, again, sort of paradigm shift that I had when I realized that everybody's kind of going through something, you know, again, watching, you know, people that are close to me pass away, that I wasn't the only person in the world that had, you know, health challenges, for example, you begin to kind of see your story in a different light. You know, can learn to embrace and appreciate the little things, human relationships, a lot of things that maybe in the past you might not have given yourself permission to do, again, because you thought that you're the only person dealing with this negativity. And in doing so, that kind of helps to put the disability or disease or whatever it is in context, and it helps you to become more empathetic. And I think just by doing all of that, you can pull out some positives. Like, it's not all uniformly bad, and it takes some practice. It's not something that comes intuitively to anybody, but it's something that just through experience you're kind of able to achieve, and you kind of learn how to kind of focus on some of the positives and pull out some of the more meaningful elements of it. I mean, it has its negatives, but it also has its positives. So I think you just train yourself to kind of pull out those positives. I think that that's one way that you can kind of tell more holistic stories than just, focusing on the negatives. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. And I think that touches upon a point that Julie made as well, where she recommended we include the highs and the positives in the story to allow the audience to also empathize with the lows. But anyone else want to comment on that question?
I would just say that for me, it comes down to sort of getting to a place where you realize, what choice do I have except to try to move forward finding the positives in this situation, not to say there aren't negatives. And, a lot of what we're focused on at Health Story Collaborative is trying to create spaces where we can help people to tell stories in ways that acknowledge the positives as well as the negatives by the questions we ask. So I think all of us can help to create more storytellers if we create spaces for story sharing and ask questions that encourage people to think about the positives.
Absolutely. So we have another question. This one is around, this comes from one of our advocates. So the question is, how do you manage the effect of living out loud and being vulnerable? Do you find that there is sometimes some personal emotional fallout from sharing your story publicly?
Yes. I think, this is Annie speaking. I mean, I think way that, in my personal experience, it's very much more about empowerment and a good feeling to do it. But anytime you put your story out there in a public way that's on the internet or anywhere publicly, you're going to have some people that aren't going to like it. Maybe that's 1%, maybe that's 2%. But that was really hard for me initially to, when I started sharing my own story, to realize that sometimes you get negative comments and you have to just not take them to heart, because the vast majority are going to be more supportive. And but I think it's part of it, part of putting it out there.
Yeah, this is Julie. I'll just add quickly that, often when I'm talking to people, I think soon after the diagnosis, people can be really, really, that's the moment where they have the most passion. They're like, I want to get involved right now because I need to change this, It shouldn't take 20 years to get a diagnosis. And sometimes I ask people to, and I love that energy, but I do ask people to try to, focus on their own journey, making sure that they're getting the right treatments and some of their own care first a little bit, because I do find that advocacy in and of itself, it does take a lot of energy, and it isn't always a positive. There is so many, and like Annie said, the positive outweigh the negative, but maybe it's how the human brain works. We seem to hear those negative really strongly, even if they are just a few. So I do try to think of it as something that, for me, I'm kind of glad that I kept it private for 2 years, and then I kind of made this big decision for myself to do a 180 and become super public. But I had that healing time of 2 years where I had a therapist, and I was just processing this, my own experience by myself before I was out there, because I'm also, you quickly become, like Chris said so beautifully, sometimes a therapist for other people. And when you're in your worst point, I don't know if you're quite ready to be that position either. So it's a great question.
Just to quickly
add
to that, I've only had a couple, let's say trolls, but people that have reacted negatively to my story. And in those instances, I kind of just like to ask questions to them, just like try to tease out sort of what might be like the underlying source of their disagreement or emotion. And I found that that helps. I mean, it obviously doesn't feel great to have somebody respond negatively to your story, but at least as long as you can go into it thinking, realizing that somebody's kind of either not having a good day or they're struggling themselves, you can at least kind of put that comment into perspective.
Absolutely. Any other last thoughts before we've unfortunately run out of time? But feel free to send in your questions, and we'll make sure that we get answers for you, the audience. But any last thoughts from any of our panelists before we close? And
yeah, this is Howard. On that last question, I wrote this blog called "How to Help People Trying to Help You," and I think it was just my story of how when I put myself out there, a lot of people gave me a lot of advice. It wasn't so much negativity, but it was more, hey, have you tried this cream? Have you done this and that? And just learning through that process how to be kind and patient and realize other people are processing what I'm going through as well. And so it takes a lot of extra emotion and effort, but I think that was a big part of my personal growth as well. Yeah.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. So I want to thank our speakers for their inspiring presentations. Each and every one of us has a story to tell, and hopefully they've provided you with a roadmap on how to turn your individual stories into our collective stories to implement change. Thank you so much for taking the time to log on to the SPM Learning Exchange. An archive of the webinar will also be available shortly. I encourage you all to also explore the resources that were shared today. Special thanks to our sponsors, Vocera and Accenture. Real quick, a few save the dates. The SPM Learning Exchange continues, and our next webinar will be held on September 11th from 1 to 2 Eastern. And the theme is Digital Health Management, Hype versus Reality. If you want to connect in person, make sure not to miss our conference on October 17th in Boston, Democratizing Healthcare, Me, You, Us, Healthocracy, which will be held the day before the Connected Health Conference. And then lastly, I encourage each and every one of you to submit your work. We want to hear from you, whether it's research, thesis you're in the midst of, policy you're helping to advance, an online community you've created, or a best practice or hack you have developed as a participatory patient, caregiver, clinician. If it falls under the umbrella of participatory medicine, we encourage you to share and become a contributor to the SPM Learning Exchange. We want to hear from you and get you involved. So you can submit your work using the following link, and if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me at sarahkrug@cancer101.org. If you're not a member, we welcome you to join the society, participatorymedicine.org. Thank you again for joining us. We hope you enjoy the rest of the day.